Under the right set of circumstances, could you be made to confess to a horrible crime you didn't commit? Author Gary Stuart thinks so. He explores the topic in his new book, Innocent Until Interrogated. It recounts the 1991 massacre at a Phoenix area Buddhist temple and the false confessions of suspects in that case. Joining me now to talk about his book is Gary Stuart, an experienced trial attorney and senior policy advisor for the Sandra Day O'Connor College of Law at Arizona State University. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining
us. Thanks for having me.
Was your aim to write about the murders or to write about false confessions?
The original aim was to write about false confessions and to put Americans into America's police stations to see what really happens some of the time. But then, when I got into the story, the murder itself was quite captivating, and then the second seemingly unrelated murder was something that I knew almost nothing about.
Well, let's get an overview of the Buddhist temple. A lot of folks probably aren't familiar with this or have a sketchy idea what happened. Talk to us about that.
Well, on August 10th, 1991, two people broke into the Buddhist temple on the west side of Phoenix. One of them had a 22 rifle, the other one had a 20-gauge shotgun. Before they left, and nobody's quite sure what happened in between, but when they left, they shot nine people, six Buddhist monks, a 75-year-old grandmother who was a nun in the monastery, her grandson, who was 17, and a young acolyte monk. And they shot them in one of the most grisly, horrific ways you could ever imagine. This was not a frenzied killing. This was a slow, methodical, purposeful killing of nine people who didn't resist their deaths. Each of these nine people were put next to one another, shoulder to shoulder, kneeling on the floor, and then forced to put their foreheads on the floor. And the shooters walked around, one shooter with the 22 rifle walked around and shot everybody in the back of the head at least once, some of them twice, a couple of them three times. The shotgun shooter walked in the opposite direction. So we have a grisly, purposeful murder that created and captivated America for a while, because they were all Buddhist monks from Thailand.
Now, let's get to the interrogation. Let's get to the original suspects who confessed to the murders.
They did.
Why did they do that?
The police induced them to confess. Those first four out of the five suspects gave patently false confessions that were not in the least bit supported by the forensic evidence at the crime scene, but nonetheless, four of those people confessed. They did it because of a complex calculus having to do with time, motivation, hopelessness, a feeling of powerlessness, and not understanding what their rights as citizens were. So they confessed over a 2.5-day period of time to a tag team of interrogators who came in seriatim, all in the same building, all at the same time, all under the same circumstances for 2.5 days. At the end of that, four of the five confessed.
Take us from there now, because as these people were confessing to something they didn't do, the people who were eventually convicted of the crime were still out there, especially one particular suspect.
Yes. So on October the 17th, some 7 weeks then after the first murders, as it turns out, A second seemingly unrelated murder occurred at a campground at Lake Pleasant, north of Phoenix. Two people were involved in that crime. They used a 9mm handgun and they shot a woman in the back three times and killed her. That seemed to be an unrelated crime, because at the time that one occurred, the same unit of detectives at the Maricopa County Sheriff's Office investigated that crime and it quickly honed in on a mental patient who was there at the crime scene, camped not far away in a separate camp, and that person confessed falsely. That person did not commit that crime any more than the first four who confessed in the Buddhist case committed their crime.
Why do people, let's get now to the bigger picture here, because, and we'll kind of intertwine this with the eventual convictions of the two that were picked up after they found out that these original suspects falsely confessed. Why do people do this?
There are lots of reasons, but I'll only take your time up on the police-induced confessions. What happens in those situations And they're rare, but they happen often enough to make it absolutely a stunning and terrifying event in American criminal justice. People become so powerless during the interrogation phase, they feel so helpless, that at some point they will do anything they need to do to get out of that room. They have to get out of that room, and they don't think they can just walk away, even though they've been read their Miranda rights and have waived their Miranda rights. But they feel powerless. There are lots of data, lots of support, lots of lawsuits, lots of cases, lots of exonerees nationwide. The Innocence Project has a separate entity in every state now. Arizona has an Innocence Project in it. It's headquartered out at the Sandra Day O'Connor College of Law. But in all of those cases, the overriding calculus is that the person finally somehow becomes totally immersed in the idea that they must have done it. In this particular case, the deputies created what they call a prop room. And in the prop room, they put photographs of the victims. They put a crime scene diagram that was drawn to scale. They showed where the bodies were at the time. And they described the cars and the weapons and the route taken to get there to these, what were then innocent suspects, but suspects that they believed had some connection because of the first of the five suspects. That guy was a mental patient in the Tucson Psychiatric Institute, and he called the police from the Psychiatric Institute while he was a patient. And he told them that he and four friends of his from Tucson committed these crimes. Within a 24-hour period, he not only confessed his own role in that, but he took the police officers to the homes of his other friends and showed them where they live. Those people were brought up to Phoenix on a Wednesday night. They were most of them were interrogated all night Wednesday, all day Thursday, half the night on Friday. And over a 2.5-day period of time, four of the five confessed because of what happened to them in the prop room.
We have so little time, but I do want to, as far as the case is concerned, how did we get the right guys?
Well, the murder weapon was actually in the hands of the police department at the time. They didn't know it at the time. They didn't know it was a murder weapon. They waited 5 weeks to examine the gun. When they did, they found out that the gun could be easily and quickly traced to three young men in the west side. They arrested all three of those young men. They're all juveniles. Two were 16, one was 17. Two of the three confessed and admitted their roles in the crime. And when they looked at the apartment of one of them, they found much of the loot, much of the evidence, and those two confessed. Ultimately, what happened is that one of those confessions, Jonathan Andrew Duty, was reversed by the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals in February of 2010 on the ground that its true confession was coerced. Mm-hmm. So now we have a case that not only involves multiple false confessions that were coerced, we now have a true confession that the court says was coerced. That's up on review.
What kind of response are you getting from law enforcement on this book and the ideas of false confessions?
It is the most rewarding thing that I could ever imagine happen. I've written, this is my sixth book, and this one is very different because of the response to the book. Police departments and police officers, the organized structure of law enforcement is very much in favor of this book, in favor of what I've revealed about the way this is happening. Police commanders have come to my lectures and my presentations on this book. Most recently, Police Officer Standards and Training Group has asked me to help them prepare a video to assist police officers or putative police officers in police academies into talking about how to avoid false confessions, because none of these police officers wanted to extract false confessions. They weren't out there trying to convict people. They were out there trying to get people to talk, to confess, that they thought were guilty when in fact they were not. So it's a wonderful, good response.
In about 10 seconds or so, if I were to say that a lot of folks would hear this and say, there's no way anyone could get me to confess to something this horrific,
then they should read this book, because the reason I wrote this book was to get Americans into this police station to show that all of us are not too smart, too strong, too capable to be manipulated into something. If we invoke our rights, then maybe we can avoid it. But if you hang around for 2.5 days like these guys did, you too might confess.
Well, Gary, it's an absolutely fascinating book. Again, Innocent Until Interrogated. Great work. Congratulations on a good book. And thank you for joining us tonight on Horizon.
Thank you.